When I was watching the first episode of Netflix's Avatar adaptation and saw this scene where Aang just tells Gyatso who he is, it felt stupid, because obviously Gyatso knows who Aang is, and the show could just show Aang having fun with his friends like it was done in the animated show. Little did I know that this type of storytelling is not a small slip in the rearranged scene they made for the introduction, but a main, if not the only storytelling tool the writers used to establish these characters.
But I'd trade places with any of them. I don't want to leave. I don't want the responsibility. I'm scared of my power. I'm scared of being alone.
I'm a warrior. I should be able to do more for our people.
You're a real waterbender, Katara.
I never wanted to fight, and I'm afraid of hurting someone.
That's because of me.
That wasn't you. That was me.
That's the only way I'm gonna save the world. With my friends.
Because all of this is my responsibility.
I mean, I'm the Avatar. It's what everyone expects of me. All I do is worry about that.
This type of storytelling not only devastates any meaningful communication between the characters, it also breaks their arcs and makes them much less believable for the viewer. But first, let's start with the basics.
My grandmother used to tell me stories about the old days, a time of peace, when the Avatar kept balance between the Water Tribes, Earth Kingdom, Fire Nation, and Air Nomads.
The original animated Avatar: The Last Airbender was a family-friendly show created to be digestible for kids, but hold much deeper meanings for a more mature viewer. It was the first show I have watched when I was a kid, and it's greatly responsible for making me connect my adult life with writing and storytelling. The show managed to explain such complex and horrifying concepts as genocide, child abuse, imposed responsibility, moral dilemmas, and redemption to a 7-year-old kid who I was at the time of my first watch. I'm not going to lie, I wasn't a fan of some childish moments in the animated series, and even as a kid I wanted to explore more deep and mature details of the Avatar universe. So when 14 years and countless rewatches of the series later, I learned that Netflix was filming a live-action adaptation that was targeted on a more mature drama audience, I felt like this could be it. I've already recovered from the last live-action adaptation attempt and was ready to watch the new adaptation without bias and nitpicking for the small details they failed to adapt, like the different eye colors based on nations. But after watching the show, I felt like the whole core of the story has been misused and turned into an entirely visual spectacle. The original story that, by all means, was beautiful from a visual standpoint, didn't have it as its point. The original show was about a journey of deep and layered characters, moving in the story through a set of complex motivations and fueled by traumas made by the horrors of war. It was a story of changes, of overcoming your flaws and facing your fears. So when I saw what Netflix did to the characters and to the story in general, I finally accepted it. Netflix does not understand Avatar. Let's start with reviewing the original show's roadmap for the story told in book 1. Here we have two parallel storylines: Aang learning to be an avatar and Zuko trying to capture him. And while Zuko's character arc remains mostly untouched, and we'll talk about the minor change in his arc that breaks the power dynamic in Avatar a bit later, but the main points of Aang's story of learning the tropes of being the avatar are turned upside down. In the original show, his journey revolves around him changing from a boy from an iceberg to an aspiring avatar. He does that through most obviously learning waterbending, but also learning responsibility, control over his powers, and he also learns how to be a good team with the gang, following up with the supporting characters arcs. These four elements of the story were the cornerstones of Aang's arc throughout book 1, and let's see how Netflix adapted it for their show. Returning to that scene in the beginning of the show, the series opens up with a backstory, showing the Air Nomad genocide, which we didn't actually see this close in the animated series. As a guy who was worried about the character adaptation, right from the start, I thought that it was a questionable decision, as it took away the amazing character bonding scene from the storm, when Aang explained the whole story of him disappearing on the day of the genocide, which saved him from dying with the rest of his people.
So you were upset that you were the Avatar? Why wouldn't you be excited about it?
Well, I didn't know how to feel about it. What's going on?
Now that you're the Avatar, it's kind of an unfair advantage for whichever team you're on.
So what? I can't play?
That's the only fair way.
Oh, okay.
But it could have been a good introduction, if not for the absolute lackluster dialogue and character introduction for Aang. Instead of showing us who Aang is, what life does he live before he learns that he is an Avatar, the showrunners make him say it to the person who knows him best as a way to establish his character, which doesn't really work because Aang does none of those things in the future and is the most serious 12-year-old kid that I've ever seen in my life.
The world needs you, Aang. You're to leave right away so you can begin training in the other disciplines.
Right away? Leave my friends? Leave home?
Always remember who you are, because I can't imagine a better person to have been given this power.
I don't want the power. Why do I have to be different? Can't I just keep pretending I'm your friend?
Almost every character interaction in this season is reduced to an emotionless exchange of long and philosophical lines that are repeated so many times throughout the season that they lose any meaning. And I'm not just talking about showing instead of telling. These rushed dialogue lines completely miss the point that they try to communicate to a viewer. For instance, in the first episode, when Aang gets defrosted out of the iceberg, the world around him changes drastically. All of his people are dead. The world is in a state of a full-scale war, and he himself was frozen for a century. For him, he was told that he was the Avatar on the same day he was defrosted. He just learned that the world's balance is in his hands, and now he learns that he was missing for 100 years. In the original show, it took Aang some time to digest these changes and accept the world as it is. But in the adaptation, he just shrugs it off and accepts it in a few lines of dialogue with Gran-Gran and Katara. In the original show, he makes a trip to Kyoshi Island, not to contact Avatar Kyoshi, but to ride an Unagi, because he still feels like a tourist and not like humanity's only hope for salvation. And only after witnessing the horrors of war that follow the Fire Nation that tries to capture him, he slowly begins to realize the responsibility he has on his shoulders. It's not bad to make Aang more serious from the start, but this lack of understanding what his character is going through and how shock and adaptation work in human psychology is exactly what ruins the viewer's connection with this character, and also ruins his character arc of overcoming his trauma throughout the season. Unfortunately, the same happens with other characters, who instead of steadily moving to fix their personal problems and flaws to progress in their story arcs, just have everything handed to them right from the start. The clearest example of it is Sokka's sexism. While I understand that including a sexist character in the show may be a bit too much for Netflix, which is clearly not, as it happens later in the story with Paku, and Netflix also has great shows revolving around discrimination and overcoming the societal barriers, like Blue Eye Samurai, cutting out Sokka's sexism in the Kyoshi Island storyline completely butchers the development that he gets from that scene. In the original show, Sokka arrives on the island as an arrogant, overconfident, and sexist character, and leaves it as a humble and accepting character. Sokka's whole arc throughout the story is one of becoming a humble leader who is ready to learn from different masters and his own mistakes, and the one who cares for his team. So what does he do in the show? Have an awkward fight lesson from Zuki and his first kiss. And while someone can argue that that's the same thing that happens in the original show, it lacks the depth of the original sequence and rids Sokka's character of any meaningful development. In the animated show, we get to see how Sokka places himself above Suki, because he's a warrior man and she's a dishwasher in his eyes, and see his worldview turn around when Suki kicks his ass. He feels embarrassed and humbled, and yet he finds enough courage in himself to come to Suki's dojo and ask to learn from her. In just this one episode, we see a 180 degree turn in his view on himself, the world, and women in particular. And this ability to make mistakes and then learn from them, change your approach and view on the world, is what makes any character a good one. Netflix does a good job at showing external changes, like Sokka learning how to fight or kiss, while fails drastically at showcasing the internal change in the characters. And the major reason why Netflix needed to make everything much more blunt and straightforward is because the show had little more than a third of the original show's duration. And while there were episodes that didn't contribute much to the story, like The Great Divide, but cutting out the moments that were necessary for developing the story of multiple characters is just criminal in this case. The most obvious thing that wasn't included in the show is Aang and Katara's waterbending training. In the whole season, the whole book one that is called Water, Aang doesn't waterbend a single time. And even when he gets to the Northern Water Tribe, he doesn't learn waterbending from Paku. I don't know how to even start explaining what a devastating blow it deals to the story. And I guess that the show itself does a better job at explaining how stupid it is not to include it.
It would have been wise to have focused on your training during your journey.
You know, you should be practicing too. The Avatar needs to master all four elements.
Maybe later.
Instead of making Aang go to the North Pole to learn waterbending from a master, they make him chase a vision from Kyoshi that isn't really something that can be explained by the lore of this world. Like, imagine if Roku had a vision of Sozin turning evil and conquering Earth Kingdom cities. There won't be this story at all. So explaining the narrative of the story through visions and destiny isn't something inherently bad. It's just not as convincing as having a real motivation. And I would have accepted it if there were no better alternatives. But in this case, I genuinely have no idea as to why Netflix decided to go this way. The funniest thing here is that they are aware how stupid this decision looks and roasted themselves with the line from Paku. By cutting out the waterbending training, Aang's character starts to miss a lot of external and clearly visible development. From the first episode to the last, his own power dynamic doesn't change a bit, as he doesn't learn how to bend the element that he needs to in order to become an avatar. Which means that from the character development standpoint, this whole adventure was just pointless. But it's only one of four things he learns in the original. Together with studying waterbending, Aang's story misses the Jongjong arc, where he tries to study firebending but ends up hurting Katara.
Katara! I'm so sorry!
Exactly at that point, he starts fearing his own power, and only after that he starts treating his power not as a toy to be played with, but as a powerful weapon that could harm those closest to him. Instead, he's just scared of his power for no actual reason. There is no moment in the season where his power puts his friends in danger, except for a scene where he sees Gyatso's corpse and enters the Avatar state. And the fact that Aang mentions how scared of his powers he is at least three times throughout the story showcases another problem I have with this show. It's not enough to write a line of dialogue telling the viewer how the character feels to make it believable. Netflix's Aang repeating this problem several times does nothing to make me believe him. Instead, it undervalues the intimacy of this fear and makes it feel like something he's not really afraid of, as he talks about it so freely. Just imagine if we got the arc with Jongjong before he starts mentioning it. We could even leave the same amount of times he tells that, but now at least we start to see the reason why he's so scared of it.
I'm scared of my power. I'm scared of being alone.
We understand that by hurting Katara, Aang becomes much less confident in himself. And by proclaiming that he'll never try to firebend again, he sets up a future conflict. As we as a viewer know that if he is to become the Avatar, he will have to learn how to firebend. So not only the showrunners have cut out the external development for Aang's character, which was the easiest to communicate by him just learning how to waterbend, they also cut out all of the more spiritual and personal lessons for him, like learning to control his powers. In episode 4, Bumi confronts Aang for disappearing for 100 years, which is obviously adapted from a season 2 episode, The Avatar State, where the Earth Kingdom general blamed Aang for not being around and tries to use Katara as leverage to make him go into the Avatar State. These two completely different moments in the animated show were surprisingly well combined to teach Aang the lesson of responsibility and having to choose. Right before the conflict's resolution, I thought to myself how good it would be if Aang entered the Avatar state to protect both himself and Bumi, and thus show how he values his old friend, but also refuses to choose who is going to die, which is directly tied to him not killing Ozai in the finale of the series. But no, instead of making Aang do something, Katara and Sokka just storm in and resolve the dilemma for him, making an argument about friendship, which has nothing to do with the main narrative of this conflict. In the Avatar State episode, which was clearly glued together with the Bumi's introduction, Aang loses control because he thinks Katara is in a grave danger. He wreaks havoc on the Earth Kingdom soldiers that were holding him back and almost kills the commander himself before regaining control. This original scene communicated both the importance of friendship and the destructive power that the Avatar State unleashes once activated. And from this same perspective, the original scene with Bumi showed how Aang went through all the trials Bumi made him to pass to save his friends, communicating the importance of his friends while simultaneously showcasing Aang's external and internal power when he passes the trials. So while on paper the mashup of these two sequences may have worked perfectly to develop Aang's character and the Avatar team as a whole, the final result is completely devoid of any meaning and lesson for the characters to learn. By resolving the conflict this way, it doesn't really contribute to the narrative Netflix wanted to communicate here. It doesn't show the power of friendship. It shows Aang's indecisiveness and makes a habit of other people dealing with his moral dilemmas for him, which wasn't even closely the case in the original show. So by doing this, Netflix have cut off Aang's progress in becoming more responsible and decisive. The third big development arc in his story this season. But the show doesn't stop on this, and they cut out important arcs to establish Team Avatar members like Katara and Sokka. While they at least make Sokka do something with the engineer they mesh together with the jet plotline, Katara's character deeply suffers from her not being established at all by cutting out the earthbending prison story and giving her the waterbending scroll without any conflict that was tied to it. I will tread very lightly on Katara's representation in the story, as her character's massacre deserves its own long video. But without proper establishment, her character looks like a Mary Sue. She only has issues with her waterbending twice throughout the whole season, and both times she gets a few dialogue lines from Aang and Jet to instantly fix the problem. This looks much darker in contrast with her character in the original show that showed how she was struggling both mentally and physically to overcome the challenges of becoming a master waterbender. This culminates in the waterbending scroll episode, where she becomes jealous of Aang being a natural waterbender and doing everything she struggled learning without any complications. This makes Katara so frustrated that she decides to steal the waterbending scroll from the pirates, and by doing this gets the whole team in a big trouble. This episode's aftermath teaches Katara not only some new waterbending tricks we see her use all the time in the future, but also teaches her humility, responsibility, and discipline. Traits without which you cannot truly become a master in anything, as you would quickly become frustrated and lose control over yourself. Of course, with cutting out Aang learning waterbending, adapting this sequence would have been a big challenge for the show's writers. But the alternative is having Katara become a self-taught prodigy that literally has no blockers on her way to mastering the element. Okay, I can't keep it in my system anymore. Katara doesn't learn waterbending from Paku, and he himself declares her the master on her own, even giving her a squad to command during the Siege of the North. Katara, a self-taught prodigy who has exactly zero training from another waterbender, and has had no problems in learning the element, which couldn't have been solved by a few witty lines of dialogue by someone she knows a few hours. When in the original show, Katara's bending also was natural. It was fueled by emotions, often by fear or frustration. She cuts the iceberg in the episode 1 out of anger on Sokka. She freezes these poor bastards out of fear, and she challenges Paku out of frustration and fights him right then and there instead of preparing a gauntlet to drop. In this adaptation, Katara looks incapable of producing any emotions and instead does all of those incredible things steadily and focused, almost like Azula would have done in the original. And before you say something about the actors, the problem is not in them. If you look at Kia Wentio, the actress who plays Katara, on her interviews, you will see that apart from being a nice person, she really is emotional, which makes me think that either Netflix wanted this change to be done intentionally, or didn't put enough emphasis on how vital it was for the actress to show these emotions. And I would say that it was intentional, as Katara's character isn't put in the situations where she would show this emotional power scaling, and instead make it inconsistent and undeserved. Like, you expect me to believe that after lifting a wave to this height, Katara struggles with a water whip? Katara's social skills also got completely destroyed by cutting out the imprisoned episode, in which she gets herself arrested in order to help captive earthbenders to riot against their Fire Nation captors. This episode shows Katara as a naive and idealist person, who believes that everyone just needs the right encouragement, which gets corrected by the harsh reality of war and of people losing hope in their captivity. Her main antagonist in this episode is not the Fire Nation Overseer, it is despair and hopelessness themselves. She tries again and again to make these people see that they have the real power to change things, and manages to convince these people to not throw their lives away and instead take them back from their oppressors. And what do we have for Katara's adaptation instead? She challenges Paku to fight, with it not being an emotional decision but a prepared one, loses to him even worse than she did in the animated series. Paku says one line about her fighting not that bad, and suddenly she becomes a popular hero, with every waterbending student wanting to be like her, and the healers standing up to Paku to let them fight while she had no interaction suggesting this with neither of those people. Netflix tries to make a suffragist hero from Katara, while not giving her any moment where she actually does something to impact the communities that she helps. I understand where Netflix was coming from with this sequence, and it's not a bad point to make, but it would have been so much better if instead of coming to Paku to ask him to fight once again, she spoke to Yagoda and encourage her and her students to take matters into their own hands and defend their tribe from the Fire Nation, while having at least some time to train them, as these women have never learned any combat abilities or anything except healing. Instead of asking permission from an unjust and sexist societal structure to change itself, she could have made the change by inspiring these women to fight. Dark times like sieges call for emergency measures, and I doubt that anyone would have minded having a hand in defending the city. But by proving that they can fight and help defend the tribe, Katara and the women she leads would have shown their worth while simultaneously not only protesting against the conservative structure of the Northern tribe, but breaking it by just being there. The idea to add this new sequence to the show isn't bad by itself, especially when they've cut out the episode where Katara does change the power dynamic in the Fire Nation prison, but it needed to be done right. Katara's character in this season is a perfect and a greatly talented waterbender that inspires people without even speaking to them, that gets credit for being a powerful bender, worthy of being the Avatar's waterbending master by losing a duel with the actual master she should have learned from. And she is the character that doesn't meet any significant challenges throughout the season that aren't fixed by a few lines from people she barely knows. And I don't mean that she is not talented in the original. I mean, she does learn bloodbending almost instantly without having to train on rats and wolves like other bloodbenders we see in the universe. It's just that her power scales from both emotions and from training. Before she started bloodbending, she learns about feeling the water in all living things from Hama, and then she was forced to take action to save her friends. And even when she learns the move from a waterbending scroll, the original show creates a conflict to support her growth and make it feel deserved. Unfortunately, the adaptation does neither. At the same time, Katara and Sokka's interactions with Aang look exactly as awkward as me when I get invited to family events. We never see a good moment of character bonding between them, except for an incredibly awkward scene in episode 1 when Katara tells Aang about her mother and explains how the firebenders attacked the South Pole. And after that, the whole interaction between them further in the story revolves around them just saying how good of a team they all are and how friendship is magic. And to cement this whole notion, instead of having Aang to learn how to communicate with the spirit world through pacifying Heibai and restoring the balance in the grove, they have Katara and Sokka kidnapped by Ko the Face Stealer. They also drop Wan Shi Tong, he who knows 10,000 things, for no actual reason other than exposition dropping. And I honestly wonder how it impacts their eventual meeting in his library. Don't you dare cut the library out of the show, Netflix. So, Ko and the Mist of Lost Souls are smashed together to produce an abomination that feeds on the despair of those caught in his webs. Ko shows us the darkest memories of Katara and Sokka. And if Katara's memory is pretty obvious, making Sokka overhear Hakoda shitting on him should be a criminal offense. Sokka and Hakoda's relationship in the original show has never had anything like they've shown in the adaptation. Instead of a genuinely loving and supporting parent, they made Hakoda a hypocrite that thinks shit of his son but doesn't help him get better and just leaves. What the actual fuck, Netflix? After seeing that scene, I thought I was also captured by Ko, but no. It was Aang, who gets out of it by remembering what's real and what's not. And it doesn't really work as it should for two reasons. Firstly, because Aang doesn't really get a scene where he needs to overcome his urge to stay in the memory. Like, imagine if he at least saw Gyatso in this moment and had to discard it for his imagination, and then meet the real Gyatso, or at least what appears to be the real Gyatso, later in the episode. It could have created at least some tension to the story. And secondly, because it has a so much cooler alternative. The scene from the original show, where Aang has to stay completely emotionless in order to speak with Ko and ask him about the water and the moon spirits, still gives me chills, like I'm watching it the first time when I was a kid. This scene was the reason why I hate horrors right to this day. And by cutting off such a cool looking, but at the same time deeply meaningful scene, and making Ko so simple in terms of his interaction with the plot, was so underwhelming for me. But I guess it would be too easy for this show Aang not to show any emotion on his face. But the resolution to this conflict is even less satisfying. In order to save Katara and Sokka, Aang has to travel to the shrine of Avatar Roku and speak to him about the ways to defeat Ko, as Gyatso tells Aang he was the only one to defeat Ko, which turns out to be untrue and just shrugged off immediately as he speaks with Iroku. God, it's so devoid of logic. In the original show, Aang must travel to the temple of Avatar Roku to learn about Sozin's comet, creating a deadline for Aang to learn and master the remaining three elements, and a driving element to the story. Roku also destroys his temple after speaking with Aang, putting an end to corrupt fire sages using his knowledge for world domination. And while I must admit that this sequence in the original must look a bit light on the happening event site, which was probably the reason why Netflix decided to add more stuff happening at the same time, but they also failed to add anything meaningful to the plot. Instead of receiving a powerful drive for progressing the story, Aang receives a totem of Mother of Faces, an item, which resolves the current problem at hand. He doesn't learn anything new, he doesn't develop his character to face the new threat, he just gets an item. To shift our attention from this stupid idea, Netflix decides to pull an even more stupid one by having June, a merc with a paralyzing badger dog, defeat 6 fire sages and ambush the Avatar. 6 firebending masters devoted to studying the secret of the Fire Nation against a merc with a stun puppy. The power dynamic in this show is really paralyzing. We'll get to that in a moment. The show also ruins the original scene when Aang has to go through the Omashu caves with Katara and set up their relationship in the future, but that just pales in comparison with other significant changes. So, overlooking these changes, I fail to find any meaningful character development for Aang, as well as the whole Avatar team, in the whole season of this show. He doesn't learn how to bend the elements, he doesn't learn to control his powers, he doesn't learn responsibility as an Avatar, he doesn't learn intricate details of interacting with the spirits, and even through interacting with the other Avatars, which wasn't a luxury Aang had so many times in the animated show, he doesn't learn anything from them. The past Avatars all as one tell Aang the same thing Guru Patik told him. God, I hope they won't cut him out as well. Not forming attachments. It's the thing that he struggles with during the endgame of Book 2, which concludes in him letting go of Katara and still not being able to save anyone, and close his Avatar state off for up until the finale. Instead of Aang having to deal with this notion in a tense and quickly changing setting of the Ba Sing Se battle, which makes him make a hard but necessary decision to let go of Katara, here it serves as a tool to create a fake conflict between Katara and Aang. Aang telling Katara she and Sokka cannot fight in the battle for the North sounds almost as stupid as Aang not learning waterbending throughout the whole season. Not only it should break the relationship between him and the gang, Katara wouldn't just stand there and take it like she did in the show, and instead tell him that he doesn't decide who fights and who hides. Which is ironic, because Katara actually fights the guy who doesn't let her fight, and the whole sequence with Aang not letting her and Sokka fight is dropped immediately after she gets train wrecked by Paku. If anything, this should have proven the fact that she shouldn't fight, as she clearly doesn't really stand a chance against an experienced opponent. But no, she is a waterbending prodigy and a self-taught master. So after we've broken down the whole roadmap of Aang's story and the complete lack of his and Katara's character development made by poor decisions in squishing the plotlines together and failing to make them make sense, let's talk about another change that directly impacts the power dynamic between the characters in the whole series and turns it upside down. The adaptation of the Blue Spirit episode was really good. I would say it was the best in the whole season, if not for a very small detail. When we explore the flashbacks behind Zuko's scar, we see that instead of refusing to fight his father in an Agni Kai, he does fight. And not only that, he almost deals a striking blow to his father, but holds back because he doesn't want to hurt him. And like, what? Fire Lord Ozai is established as the most powerful firebender in the world at the moment. It's backed by the world-building materials and it's communicated through the narrative of the original show as being something everyone acknowledges. Ozai's 13-year-old son besting him but not dealing the blow on the eyes of the whole court is something that would have raised a lot of eyebrows from his nobles, especially when Netflix creates a plotline with the conspirators against the throne. Zuko's story is the one of a struggling firebender, haunted by not being as good as his sister, but never giving up. This stubbornness, in combination with his conflicted nature, is what makes Zuko himself.
I loved watching you. That's who you are, Zuko. Someone who keeps fighting even though it's hard.
The original series made it very clear that even after the training with the dragons and reigniting the fire within Zuko, he is still no match for his father. He doesn't even think he is capable of taking Azula on his own in the finale. That's why he takes Katara with him as backup, only agreeing to the Agni Kai after he notices a change in Azula's temper and behavior. It's not about Ozai punishing Zuko for holding back instead of striking your opponent dead. It's about Zuko technically winning the duel against his father. Zuko isn't a bad firebender, but during his teenage years, he struggled with being as good as other members of his family. This is one of the reasons of his trauma, not fitting in, not being good enough, but still fighting on and being stubborn. By making Zuko not only able to outmaneuver his father, but actually having a clear shot in his father's head in this duel, Netflix completely destroys the established power structure that is keeping Ozai in power. If Zuko can overcome his father at 13 years of age, imagine what he can do with more experience and practice. And if we accept this as the new power dynamic, do we also assume that Azula could end her father right then and there and assume her place as the new Fire Lord at the age of 14? Because Zuko being punished not for refusing to fight his father, but for holding back when he had a clear shot, doesn't make sense in Azula's plotline as well. Because she also challenges Ozai and makes a warning shot of lightning right next to his face. Isn't it exactly what Zuko was banished for? Challenging his superiors and holding back because of respect? But Azula's character also gets train wrecked, when she isn't even supposed to be in the season. Azula's interaction with Ozai was always about fear and obedience. She, whether she wants to admit it or not, is terrified of her father and would never do such a rash and disrespectful thing as shoot lightnings right next to his face in order to prove her worth. Ozai, in his turn, knows exactly how worthy Azula is, which helps him manipulate her into being the perfect weapon he needs. The only thing Azula wanted throughout all of her childhood was her father's approval, and she always managed to get it when she exceeded expectations and managed to get things done. In this show, Azula is not this kind of person. She is driven by personal thirst for power, she is impatient, unfocused, and by all means she isn't a perfectionist she used to be in the animated series. Azula's character arc in the original show has always been one of overcoming any obstacle that was put before her. She was made into a perfect weapon. Most of all, she was aware and willing of her role and enjoyed only perfection. In the adaptation, the showrunners decided to make Azula the struggling one. She doesn't have her iconic blue fire, she doesn't mop the floor with any enemy that Ozai puts before her, and most of all, she isn't driven by perfection, as she is in the original. If her hair gets out of place while she demonstrates one of the most deadly techniques in the whole Avatar world, it's unacceptable. If she loses a beach volleyball game to some low-ranking noble teenagers, it's shameful. Adding a setup sequence for her in season 1 is a good idea by itself, but the way Netflix does it breaks the whole idea behind the character. Something that leads her through the story, and something that becomes her downfall in the end. When in book 3, Ozai leaves to conquer the Earth Kingdom, following Sozin's comet, he leaves Azula behind, discarding her to claim this victory only for himself. For the first time in the series, we see how betrayed she feels. "You can't treat me like Zuko," she says, "because it's Zuko who was imperfect. It's Zuko who didn't get things done, and he was the one who suffered for it." She was always on Ozai's side, obediently doing anything he asks. From conquering Ba Sing Se, to risking her own life to distract Team Avatar during the Day of the Black Sun. And even the throne of the Fire Lord didn't give her the satisfaction, because the throne wasn't the thing that she wanted. She wanted to be by her father's side, doing his bidding in eradicating the world as we know it. Azula's interaction with other people has always been one of intimidation and total control. When she was introduced in the original series, she threatens to throw her ship's captain to the sea for not docking when she wants it. She intimidates both the Fire Nation soldiers and Dai Li in the fight for Ba Sing Se. And she uses the same tactics while recruiting Tai Li and Mei to her squad, carefully manipulating their uncertainties and showing that the only way they can achieve self-worth is by helping her. And when she sees that her strategy of intimidation and manipulation no longer works, and those who she thought could have never opposed her, those who she thought would be terrified of her, started to betray her, she starts losing her mind and becomes paranoid of anyone around her. So Azula doesn't know how to connect with people on a personal level. She knows nothing of inspiring love and affection to her people. And yet, the show makes her seem like an inspiring leader, fighting within the ranks and cheering her soldiers up after taking Omashu. And while I don't necessarily think she couldn't have had the same scene in the original series, the lack of representing the qualities crucial for her character takes her personality further from what it was in the original show. Azula is one of my favorite villains in fiction, mostly because of how the show depicts her philosophy, how it works perfectly in the short-term perspective, and how it ruins her life from inside over time. Azula's arc depicts how a narcissistic perfectionist slowly drives herself insane, no longer able to support her strategy of manipulation and striking fear into her followers. And the Netflix adaptation's Azula is nowhere near this kind of person, which can only mean one thing: they've ruined yet another character from the original. The one that wasn't even supposed to be here, and yet somehow got destroyed before even coming into the story. But it's not even the end of it. For some reason, Netflix decided to destroy yet another layered and deep character, that was Zhao. Not only the whole sequence with Zhao being Azula's puppet breaks his erudite and intelligent personality, turning him into an ironically a much more cartoonish villain, which he already was, but at least had some brains in his head, and actually was the last one to visit the library of Wan Shi Tong, he who knows 10,000 things. It also makes no sense for Azula. While I can understand that Azula wants to spy on Zuko in order to get updated about what's going on with him, sending Zhao to conquer the North and potentially end the Avatar threat while he still haven't learned waterbending, and take all the credit for it, seems completely out of her character. The only time Azula willingly gives up the credit for her win is when she presumably kills the Avatar and tells Ozai that Zuko killed him.
"And I am proudest of all of your most legendary accomplishment. You slayed the Avatar."
"What did you hear?"
"Azula told me everything."
"Why did you tell Father that I was the one who killed the Avatar?"
"Unless somehow the Avatar was actually alive, all that glory would suddenly turn to shame and foolishness."
She recognizes that after taking Ba Sing Se, the achievement thought impossible by the previous generation, the fight that cost Fire Nation countless lives and even a potential crown prince, taking the city from inside without any casualties, will cement her place as Ozai's most trusted person in the whole Fire Nation. Ozai's trust in Zuko, however, fully depends on him killing the Avatar. And when Ozai discovers that the Avatar is alive, he discards Zuko and makes Azula his formal heir. That's why taking the North Pole and capturing the Avatar right then and there is a luxury she couldn't afford to throw away for some commander in the Southern Fleet, while she herself would lead an attack on Omashu, a city that is important but pales in comparison with a Northern Water Tribe. Concluding the segment about bad changes in character arcs that Netflix made, we have this scene with Iroh, where he, being a prisoner of Earth Kingdom soldiers, explains his attack on Ba Sing Se by him just being a soldier.
We were at war. I was a soldier.
You were a butcher.
This is nitpicking, and I can definitely say that Iroh's character was adapted pretty well, especially with new scenes of dialogue that really puts a spotlight on his wonderful character. And we'll talk more about good changes in a few moments. But this scene feels totally out of character for Iroh. First of all, he wasn't just a soldier, he was a crown prince, who at that time was pretty enthusiastic about the Fire Nation's nationalist ideas and worked hard to ensure the Fire Nation's success in the war. If his son was alive, he would took Ba Sing Se, return to the Fire Nation as a hero who conquered the Earth Kingdom, and eventually ascend to the throne of the Fire Lord, succeeding Azulon. Iroh was a warlord, and his actions brought death and suffering to thousands, if not more people, only in Ba Sing Se. But he never gives it much of a thought until his son dies in the battle. From other side, at the time the Avatar story begins, Iroh is a very different man. He made a journey into the spirit world, which by the way wasn't mentioned in the adaptation, which sounds a bit concerning for me. He also is a member of White Lotus, and he also lied about killing the last dragon to protect the legacy of the original Firebenders. Actually, last two things happened before the death of Liu Tan, at least in the original timeline, but we can all agree that after Liu Tan's death, he probably focused more on preserving the knowledge and the balance in the world, as well as reflecting on his own actions in the past and changing his life views. In both of these versions of Iroh, he would never say he was just a soldier. They could have made him not respond to this question at all, or say something like, "We are at war and this was my duty as general," but not downscale his involvement in the war effort to make it sound like he was just a pawn in someone else's game. This siege was Iroh's plan, his endgame for winning the war, and maybe some other less reflecting character would have said something like this, but not Iroh. Iroh understands the role he played and understands the cost that he paid for it. He still isn't fully redeemed at this point, as he still considers himself Fire Nation and he helps Zuko in capturing the Avatar. His turning point happens after Zhao attacks Zuko and after he kills the Moon Spirit. So he can act hostile to the Earth Kingdom soldier, just like he did in the original series, but not like that. To finalize this breakdown of poor changes made by the showrunners, I think that it's actually really fitting how Ozai finalizes the season by saying that the Northern attack was just a distraction for taking Omashu. Distraction for who? Northerners are pretty isolated, and they weren't involved in the fighting in the Earth Kingdom. Avatar is not a threat, and even if he was, he still needed to go to the Northern Pole to learn waterbending from a master, which I guess isn't the case. The only people who defended Omashu were the Earth Kingdom soldiers, particularly the ones loyal to Bumi. So who was meant to be distracted by an attack on the Northern tribe? I guess we won't ever know the answer to this question. Now, let's talk about the good changes, or at least the promising ones, that bring something new to the story without breaking anything in it. First of all, more scenes with Iroh. Even the scene with the Earth Kingdom soldier, where Iroh's response felt out of place for me, was actually a good adaptation of something similar happening in the original show. Having this soldier tell the story of how the war impacted him and his loved ones with having restrained to leave Iroh alive for the trial in the Earth Kingdom, is honestly very heartbreaking. It is a wonderful scene when we as a viewer can sympathize with both sides and even tip the scales against one of the most beloved characters in the fantasy genre. It adds depth to the story and emphasizes something that the animated show couldn't do because of the family friendliness. That Iroh did have a dark background, which makes his redemption and future atonement for his crimes feel much more deserved. Even with what Iroh said in that scene, I hope Netflix will explore this topic more when Iroh and Zuko arrive to Ba Sing Se as refugees, and will probably encounter much more hate of Iroh and the Fire Nation than they did in the original series. Or not. There is no war in Ba Sing Se after all. The show also adds more backstory for Zuko and Iroh's relationship, showing Zuko helping Iroh to recover after the loss of his son, and this wholesome scene where Iroh tells him that everything he needs is already on Zuko's ship. They also added some interaction between Iroh and Ozai, which ironically wasn't the case in the original show, because the two never spoke to each other on the screen, so that's a good thing. These flashbacks aren't without their problems, and we've discussed them before, but they greatly contribute into our understanding of these characters and their future dynamic together. It would be much more heartbreaking to see Zuko betraying his uncle after seeing these two scenes of their interaction. The plotline with the rebels was also a great addition. It also created layers for the Fire Nation as a country, showing that even though the nationalist brainwashing machine has been working for a century, there still are people who are ready to lay down their lives to put an end to the Fire Lord's oppression. It makes us see that not all Fire Nation people are villains, and not all Earth Kingdom people are heroes, which adds complexity to the story and makes the world seem alive and human. Now, let's talk about Gyatso. First of all, bringing the Air Nomad genocide to the screen is a great idea all by itself, and it had great moments of showcasing the power of airbending masters and the genocide itself as it happened. But there are two minor details that I think should have been done differently. First of all, Sozin's comet. In the animated show, it painted the sky red and made the firebender's bending incomparably stronger to their regular one. In this scene, even though they have shown us the comet, I forgot about its existence after a few seconds. It doesn't hit as hard as the comet fights in the animated series finale, and the firebenders don't even seem stronger, they just use their regular attacks. I think Netflix knew about this, and it probably was a technical problem more than a writing mistake, because they even have Sozin explicitly point that out before killing Gyatso.
"They have prevailed on another night, but not when we have the power of the comet."
But I honestly don't know what went wrong here. It's not like color grading is that hard to adjust, especially for a big studio like Netflix. But the gigantic beams of fire that the animated show had are probably a bit costly to make. And the second thing is my personal nerd's nitpicking of enormous levels. In the original show, we see Gyatso surrounded by corpses of the Fire Nation soldiers, and the popular and most likely correct fan theory is that Gyatso just sucked the air out of the room, blocking the Fire Nation soldiers from firebending, as there was no oxygen in the air for it to burn, and suffocating both the Fire Nation soldiers and Gyatso himself. Avatar Yang Chen does something like this in the books, and Zaheer uses a very similar technique to kill the Earth Queen in Avatar Korra. So I thought if the family-friendly rating was no longer an issue, Netflix would definitely show this on the screen, establishing both how deadly airbending can be and how selfless Gyatso was by sacrificing himself to save the others. But to my disappointment, there was no such scene, and instead the showrunners wanted to establish Sozin through him killing Gyatso. We don't see more of Gyatso in the original show, but the showrunners decided to bring him back as a sort of a spiritual mentor for Aang, which was a great scene that gave us a wonderful moment where Gyatso tells Aang that the genocide wasn't his fault, something that the original Aang never heard from his master. I think that this was a great addition, even though it gets lost in other moments of poor writing decisions. And also, they have set up something weird with Gyatso not being around when Aang returns to the spirit world, which means either that they've made this scene Aang's hallucination, or a vision from the spirit world, which isn't a very good thing by itself, or they have set up a new plotline with Gyatso, which will be explored in the future seasons. I honestly don't know. But the scene itself was very wholesome. And before making the conclusion, I want to say a few words about the actors. There are some real problems with acting in the show, especially from Aang and Katara's actors. But it's not their fault at all. First of all, if you've seen the interviews and saw how these actors interacted with each other, you would see that they are funny, emotional, and socially relaxed teenagers who have good screen chemistry with each other. I genuinely felt some kind of dissonance between what I saw from them on the interview and in the show. It was like they were specifically told to not express any emotions, and the set probably was tense enough so these guys didn't feel relaxed to play their roles. Because they are a good match for the characters, and they definitely can act according to the characters they play. So there must be some sort of an issue behind the scenes that limited their expressions to what we saw on the screen. And the second thing, with the story written as it is, even the great actors wouldn't have been able to save it. With all of the vital story beats gone, the show just looks like a visual performance with no idea behind it. Making a conclusion, I want to say that although I said a lot of unpleasant things about this show, I don't want it to sound like I'm hating on the show, and especially not hating on anyone involved in it. I haven't seen what's going on behind the scenes, and judging by how the original creators of the story left the team after quote-unquote creative differences, it's not really my place to judge. My goal in this video was to express my opinion as of a lifetime fan of the universe and to highlight the weak links in this adaptation to understand how to make it better. With the official announcement of the upcoming book 2 and 3, I hope that Netflix will work on fixing these problems and give the writers and the cast enough creative freedom to produce a great story adaptation, while at the same time continuing the new plotlines they've created this season. If you have enjoyed this video, please consider giving it a like and subscribing to my channel. My latest video has blown up with around 200,000 views at this moment, and we've passed 1,000 subs pretty quickly, so I wanted to thank all of you for helping me turn this silly hobby into a real deal. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Until then.